Good morning and welcome to our worship time together. 1 Peter 4:10 tells us each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. Spiritual gifts are supernatural empowerments given by the Holy Spirit to the followers of Christ so that we can do the work of building up the body of Christ, the church, and extend the kingdom of God throughout the world. God graces us with spiritual gifts among many other gifts and blessings, and he calls us to be stewards, managers of them. This morning, let's join our hearts together to praise and worship the Lord, the giver of all good gifts. Lord, we thank you for the privilege that we have of worshiping you, of lifting up your name. We praise you, Jesus. We thank you for your love, for your mercy, for your grace, and for the gifts that you've poured into our lives. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. We pray that he'll speak to us as we worship this morning, as we worship together, as we worship in our homes. Lord, we pray that you would teach us and mold us and grow us more and more into your image. In Jesus' name, amen.
Standing here, not knowing how we'll get through this test, but holding on to faith you know best, that nothing can catch you by surprise. You've got this figured out, you're watching us now. But when it looks as if we can't win, you wrap us in your arms and step in, and everything we need you supply. You've got this in control, and now we know that you've made a way. When our backs were against the wall and it looked as if it was over, you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way. Now we're here, looking back on where we've come from. Because of you and nothing we've done to deserve the love and mercy you've shown, your grace was strong enough to pick us up, and you've made a way. When our backs were against the wall and it looked as if it was over, you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way. You move mountains, you cause walls to fall. With your power, you perform miracles. There is nothing that's impossible, and we're standing here only because you move mountains, you cause walls to fall. With your power, you perform miracles. There is nothing that's impossible, and we're standing here only because you made a way. You've made a way. You've made a way. don't know how, but you did it, made a way. I don't know how, but you did it, made a way. I don't know why, but I'm grateful, made a way. I don't know why, but I'm grateful, made a way. You've made a way. When our backs were against the wall and it looked as if it was over, you've made a way. And we're standing here only because you made. And we're standing here only because you made. And we're standing here only because you made a way.
Good morning. We had an awesome week with our virtual vacation Bible school. It was different for us, but we had 85 children participating from four different states and from Mexico. We've collected $1,053, and then we have our match for $1,000, so we are donating $2,053 to the Vano family for their missions project. We are going to keep the project open. They actually need another $4,000 about for the well project, so we want to keep that open, and you are welcome to give any time so that we can help them finish that project. Today, Pastor Hank is going to be talking about spiritual gifts. I want to read Romans 12, 6 to 8 to you. We all have gifts. They differ in keeping with the grace that God has given each of us. Do you have the gift of prophecy? Then use it in keeping with the faith you have. Is your gift to serve? Then serve. Is your gift teaching? Then teach. Is it telling others how they should live? Then tell them. Is it giving to those who are in need? Then give freely. Is it being a leader? Then work hard at it. Is it showing mercy? Then do it cheerfully. I have some gifts on paper here that I just want to kind of define to you. They're not all spiritual gifts, but they are gifts that we have. The first one is to be affectionate, if you'd like to show love. And giving, you'd like to share. And being a server, you'd like to help others. Being a leader, when there's a job to do, you like to get it done. Showing mercy, you feel sorry for people who are sad or sick or in need, and you want to help them. A teacher, you like to help others learn how to do things. We have a lot of teachers in our church with the kids ministry. Patient, you can wait without getting upset. Humorous, you make people laugh by things you say and do. A hard worker, you don't quit until the job is done. Dependable, people know that you will do what is asked of you. A friend. You are kind and willing to be a friend. We have a lot of friends in kids ministry. And honest. You tell the truth. So in the email that your parents have received or in your activity bags if you're here for the live service, you will see a gift survey. It's a spiritual gift survey for kids. It's a small gift survey. It actually only shows four different gifts. I'd like you to take the time and fill out this spiritual gift. You just answer the question, it says, I am good at, and then you circle which one is you, and then you add up the columns at the bottom to find out what your spiritual gift is. I would love for you to do that with your parents. They can help you through it. Sometimes you may see that you have a couple spiritual gifts, or you may see that none of these are really your spiritual gifts. God is going to help you through that as you grow. Sometimes we need others to help us discern our spiritual gifts. I want to encourage you and other and the adults around to encourage each other with spiritual gifts. When we see someone with a gift, to share it with them, to let them know, I think God is teaching you this and helping you. You have this gift to do whatever, whether it's to serve or to lead or to preach or to teach, that God is giving you a spiritual gift. Sometimes we don't know what our spiritual gifts are. I want to share a really quick story with you. Many years ago, I didn't really know what my gifts were. I knew I'd like to teach kids, and I also like to meet and connect with people. I served as the junior church coordinator for years and then the nursery and toddler coordinator right here at this church for about 15 years. And when Pastor Kirsten was stopping as our children's pastor, you guys know Pastor Kirsten. She is DJ and Marina and Hava's mom. She was a wonderful children's pastor and taught me many things. Well, she was going to stop being children's pastor. And in one day, I had three people encourage me, all in the same day, to apply for her job. I thought they were all crazy. I laughed at them all. But they told me that God was telling them to tell me to apply, because God had given me the spiritual gifts. We can have gifts, and sometimes we need others to show us what those gifts are, and that God has given us those gifts. If it wasn't for people encouraging me, I would never have applied for the job, ever. I love being the children's pastor, but God was leading others to encourage me to use my spiritual gifts because I didn't believe in myself. I see some of you with the gift of serving, others with the gift of being a leader or a preacher, and teachers, the gift of mercy, and other spiritual gifts. It's okay to not know what your spiritual gift is yet, but be open to know that God is leading you and what he is teaching you. God wants you to love him and serve him, and since you're part of this church body, you are important and you are needed. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for giving us the gifts. Help us to use our gifts for your work and your glory. Help us to encourage each other and help us to build each other up. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're at the portion of our service now where we dedicate our giving to God. Again, I remind you, you can give to the church by direct mail, or you can turn to the website of the church, and in the upper right-hand corner, there's a place you can press, and it will tell you all the electronic ways you can give to the church. Will you please join with me in prayer? Lord, we thank you. I was thinking about this offering today and the giving to the church, and I've kind of scanned over 40 years in my mind. You've gotten us through every kind of season, every kind of project, times when things seemed easy, times when things were hard. And through all of that, I thank you for your faithfulness. And I thank you for your faithfulness now, both in terms of being faithful to us as individuals and as a church. Please bless those who are able to give, and thank you for their generosity. And Lord, for those who are not able to give, please bless them, guide them, help them through these tough times. Make a way, Lord, we pray. We dedicate this offering in your name so that the world may see your goodness and come to know you. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen.
Praise God. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
It is time in our service for our congregational prayer. Please join me in prayer. Father, we praise you for this day. We thank you for your almighty hand and your presence in our lives. Lord, we thank you for the ways that you answer prayer. We thank you that you answer our prayers, even in those times when we don't quite even send them up to you. We praise you for your work in our lives. We praise you for the ways we can look back and just see your guidance, your blessings, your provisions. Lord, we thank you for the fellowship of our church family. We thank you for the ways you've provided for connections. Lord, we thank you so much for your great love for us and your gentleness and care. Lord, we ask today that you would help us to give you all of our hearts. Thank you for the ways that you use us. We ask that we just continue to submit ourselves to you. We thank you for the ways that you bestow spiritual gifts upon us. Help us to be available, pursue you, Lord, for the ways that you can use us. And we thank you for being able to see the ways that we get to join in your kingdom work. We ask that we continue to pursue those ways. Praise you for the different ways those of us in our community are able to serve you and honor you. Lord, today we also ask special blessings on our missionaries, those who are here, those who are away, those who are stuck, maybe not where they want to be. We ask that you bless them in this time. If they're separate from their ministry, Lord, we ask that you would give them a peace. May your Spirit guide them and continue to give them vision for their ministries. We ask that you bless the leaders that they've left behind. Bless those leaders as they guide and lead and have those opportunities. We ask for continued new vision for the missionaries, that they would know which way your Spirit is leading them, particularly in this time. Lord, we ask that you be with all of our ministries here at HBIC. Renew our visions. Show us the ways to minister and reach out. Show us where you're working. Lord, help us to lift one another up in the work of your kingdom. We ask your blessings on this service today. Be with those who are sick among us. May your healing hand be upon them. Those who are healing from surgeries. Those with transitions ahead, Lord. We praise you for, again, your evident hand, and we just ask for peace, comfort, healing, and bless those who are in the support positions. We love you, Lord, and we ask this all in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. We're so glad you're joining us this morning. What a great blessing we have on this YouTube channel to be able to share with you our service this morning. We're grateful for you joining locally, regionally, and also to our friends in other parts of the world. Thank you for being with us. Every week, our hope is that this service is a blessing to you. It's a help, and that this is an opportunity to meet. The writer of the Hebrews says we should not neglect meeting together, and even though we can't physically be together, praise God for technology that allows us to unite our hearts and to be united by the Spirit as we sit together in our living rooms, but being united in one in Christ. We're continuing our sermon series this week on stewardship. And when we said stewardship, it's just this idea that God invites us into partnership. He owns everything. Everything that we have belongs to him, yet God has chosen to partner with us, and he's called us to be the managers of everything that he's gifted to us. Stewarding is a trust. You know, it's a trust that God places in us, but it's also a chance for us to help and to partner with him. And in that partnering, we become more and more like Christ. We become more like Christ because we help others. We become more like Christ because we grow into Christ-likeness. And we become more like Christ because the work that we do is for the glory of God and for the kingdom of God. We start off talking about stewarding our resources, and we said, hey, all of our money, everything, it belongs to God. How can we use that for the kingdom? Then we moved on to our assets, maybe the things that we purchase or the things that we have. And we said, well, yeah, all that I have belongs to God too. How do we give that to God? And one way is to hold those things loosely and to be hospitable with them. And last week, we talked about stewarding one another. The idea here is that we belong to God, but we also belong to each other. So how we live with each other is it should not only model Christ-likeness, but it should keep us grounded in this reality that our unity is made in Christ, yes, but we belong to each other. Everything we do should be for God and for one another. And then this week, we're going to continue on by talking about spiritual gifts. Now, spiritual gifts are divinely appointed to grow us. us, to grow others, and they're for God's glory and God's kingdom. They're gifts that God has given to the whole church, meaning that everyone who chooses to follow Jesus gets a spiritual gift or gifts in many cases. And it's for the church in the sense of where you are, and it's also for the greater church, because I believe that what we do not only goes on for eternity, but what we do locally doesn't just stay locally, because the people we invest in aren't always going to be locally with us. As they go into the world, that investment that we've made, we can see the church being the church. This morning, I'll be reading from Romans 12, verses 3 to 8. If you have your Bibles, turn with me, but I'm just going to open up in a quick word of prayer. Father God, we thank you so much for the blessing of your Son, Jesus Christ, the ultimate gift for us. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the blessing of the Holy Spirit that you've left behind to help us do your work. Lord, Holy Spirit, we thank you that these gifts that you administer, these gifts that you illuminate, these gifts that you grow in us are truly for your people to be empowered, are truly for us to partner with you, are truly for us to go into the world and share Jesus Christ. Lord, help us now as we get into the scripture. Bless us and keep us and use us for your glory. In your holy and precious name, amen. In Romans 12, I'll be reading verses 3 to 8, starting at verse 3. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts, according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance to your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. So the background of Romans 12 is that you have this great chapter where Paul, after, you know, spending the first 11 chapters, he gets to the chapter 12 and says, okay, you need to live for Christ. You need to give it all for Christ. And he starts off by telling them to offer up their bodies as living sacrifice to a culture that knew sacrifice, to a culture that knew that I had to find the perfect lamb and get it ready and offer it up and hope that's good enough to God. And now Paul is saying, no. With Jesus, he's the ultimate sacrifice for all your sins. But now that you believe in Jesus, your body should be given to God for his glory. And he talks about the mind next, and he says, yeah, part of your body is your mind, but that mind of yours has to be renewed, right? It has to be transformed by the Holy Spirit, which is then going to form you into Christ's likeness. And then he, before we get to our section is kind of pancaked in the middle, right? But in the end, he gives exhortations. We talked about some of these exhortations last week in our passage. And he gives another set here. And I think what I love about these exhortations and encouragements and urgings is that these are not things that Paul is saying that people are going to be like, I just don't understand what he's saying. They're very clear. And I think the other thing that's really important about them being very clear is that they may not be an exhaustive, all-encompassing list, although when I go through them now, it's going to seem exhaustive and all-encompassing. But why he gives this is because all of us are going to struggle to do some of these things, or maybe all of these things. And what he wants to point us to is that our goal is Christ's likeness. If we want to live and love like Christ, we have to hate evil and cling to what is good. We have to be devoted to each other. We have to put others above ourselves consistently. We have to ask God to help us not lose that fire, not lose our spiritual fervor. We have to be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. We have to share with those in need. We have to be people who are hospitable. In a world that says, take, 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 my, me and mine, we have to give, and work for us, not just me. We have to bless and not curse, even those who persecute us. We have to rejoice together. We have to mourn together. If we're truly the body of Christ, when you hurt, I feel and I hurt with you. Yet when you rejoice, I celebrate and rejoice with you. We have to live in shalom with one another, harmony with one another, working for the good of the cosmos, yes, working for the good of creation, yes, but working for the good of each other to please God. We have to trust God to make things right. In a world that says, I will get you back, vengeance is mine, we have to trust God that he's the God of all justice, and he's the one who will make things right. And lastly, Paul closes this section, and this is probably one of the hardest ones. When we live in a world where it's so easy to see darkness all around us, and if we're honest, sometimes it's so easy to see darkness deep inside of us, because we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. Paul says, don't be overcome by evil. Overcome evil with good. And I'll just buffet that with, remember what Jesus says, don't be scared of this world, for I have overcome the world. Don't be overcome by evil, sisters and brothers. Overcome evil with good. So yes, give your bodies to God, let it be used for your glory. Give your mind to God, let it be transformed so you can grow into Christ-likeness. Live and love like Jesus. And then in the middle, he says, use your spiritual gifts. Use your spiritual gifts for God's glory and for the kingdom. Now, spiritual gifts are divinely appointed, so they're very different than natural gifts or natural skills and natural abilities. And this is the best I could come up with, you know, but this is what I thought about. You know, I have a natural gift to taste and tell if something's delicious. That is not a spiritual gift. It's just a natural gift. If you bring me food, I will taste it and tell you, not quite delicious, right? I have a natural gift to tell what's delicious. I also have a natural skill to eat everything that's delicious. You know, if you bring it in front of me, I will eat it. It's a natural skill. I know I'm blessed. I know, right? And I have the ability, though, to eat it over again and again. So if you keep making me delicious things, like Patty Schradley makes me cheesecake, I will keep eating it again and again. It's this natural ability I have. None of those things are spiritual gifts. Spiritual gifts are not what you do naturally or what comes easy to you sometimes. It's not, you know, what skills you have, although you can develop them, and it's not abilities, right? Although all those things can be used by God for the kingdom. They are divinely appointed, meaning that these are offices, is the language that Paul uses in the Greek. Really, these are things that God has given you, not for you, but for the kingdom, for your sisters and brothers. It's designed to maybe grow you in your faith, but more importantly, to grow others in their faith. It's designed to build them up so that God's glory can be seen, so that the kingdom can keep coming. These are gifts that God has given to the church, meaning that everyone who chooses to follow Jesus will get at least one spiritual gift. And then in the growth in Christ, as you become more and more like Christ, you might see your gifts expand. It's a gift that's for the church as a whole, yes. But again, it's for the local church, meaning where you are, that body that you're a part of. And I think this is very, very important, because we live in a culture now that is seemingly forgetting that we're called to be the body of Christ. We live in a culture where it's very, very easy to say everything the church is not, and every way the church falls short. But we have to be mindful that what God's left behind is the Spirit and the church. And you can critique the institution, but we have to remember that it is not our job to tear each other apart. Our job is to tear apart systems that keep people from God's glory, systems that deny people the truth of who God calls them to be. We need to break down the systems, but not each other, because we are the church, and we're the ones God's left behind. And these spiritual gifts are given us to empower and to build up and not to tear down. Now, if you want a complete listing of the spiritual gifts, you have to combine a bunch of Bible passages, and I still don't know if you'll get all of them. Paul has a list in Ephesians 4. And in 1 Corinthians 12, he has an even longer list. Peter's list I like, because he says, anyone who speaks or anyone who serves or doing the work of God, that's the spiritual gift. But in this passage in Romans 12, 3-8, I picked this passage because when I read through all these things this week, I realized that of all these passages, Paul is intentionally building this list on the idea of stewardship. Paul's list of spiritual gifts found in Romans 12 is founded on stewardship. For example, your gifts, your spiritual gifts, are a resource. Just like we said about resources, right? It's not for you, it's for the church. It's about assets. And just like when we said assets, it's not about what you have, it's not even about you. It's what God can do through you. And it's about one another. Your spiritual gifts are so you can love, serve, encourage this family of faith. But you know what else I found? is that this word that Paul uses time and time again in Romans 12, 3 to 8. In the Greek, you know, in English, we just read it as have, you know, for we have many members in one body. And it comes back again, it's like we have different gifts. You see this word coming over and over again. You know, that word isn't just about possessing something, like I have it. In the Greek, there's a sense of, get this, stewardship. So you can read, for example, verses 3 as, do not think more highly of yourself than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance to the faith God has distributed each of you. God has given each of you to steward. So when you read these spiritual gifts, Paul is saying these are not just things that we have, but these are things that are meant to be stewarded for the kingdom, for the glory of God's body. And in our passage, he starts off with the first thing you got to do with your spiritual gifts. The first thing you got to do in this life is to be humble. We see the humility of Jesus our Christ in that he spoke the world into existence. He created everything that was, yet he came in the form of not just a servant. He had to grow into a servant. He came in the form of a helpless baby in a manger with his life in danger. And Africa had to take him in. I had to throw that in there. You always got to throw in that because, you know, Africa saves people. That's what we do, you know? But when we think about Jesus' humility, we realize that's how we are to live. And I love the juxtaposition that Paul paints here, right? He's like, you know what, man? Don't overthink about how valuable you think you are, you know? Don't put yourself on that pedestal. You know, actually, think of yourself reasonably with sober judgment. Think of yourself as someone that God has loved, someone that God has chosen, someone God has gifted, not for you, but for his kingdom. Every gift that we have should be used for God's glory and God's kingdom. Simple as that. We have to work as humble servants because our humble Messiah is Jesus, and that's who we follow. The first way to steward your spiritual gift is to be humble like Christ is humble. The second way is to be the body. We belong to each other. We talked about that last week. But Paul gives these gifts to remind us that when we are the body of Christ, it is not just, again, a theological, intellectual concept. It's a physical concept. Every part of your body has a function. And without that function, you will be limited in a certain way. So Paul is saying this, you know, we are a body, meaning that no member is self-sufficient. And again, I talk to my sisters and brothers who've gotten so good at critiquing everything the church is not. You are not called to be self-sufficient. You're not called to do it on your own. You're called to walk together with us. We're called to do this together. If you are living lives of self-sufficiency, of just you and God, you are not being like Christ. You are not being the church. You are not being the body. Aren't you glad that your knee doesn't want to be self-sufficient? Aren't you glad that your heart doesn't want to be self-sufficient? Aren't you glad that your brain doesn't want to be self-sufficient? We have all these different parts, but together make one body. No member is self-sufficient. The other side of that is for those of us who maybe have power, or those of us who have influence in the church, or those of us who have more vocal or at least more upfront gifts. It's a reminder that Paul is saying here that, yeah, no member is self-sufficient, but no member, nobody is expendable either. Everybody matters in Christ. Every gift matters in Christ. Everybody in the body has work to do. This isn't the type of work, or this isn't the type of journey where people get to do the heavy lifting and you just get to sit by and watch it and cheer them on. Although cheering could be a gift if you're encouraging. But that encouragement is work then. Everyone has work to do. Being the body saying we belong to each other. But being the body is remembering that we're not meant to be an island. We're not meant to do this alone. Being the body means that every single person has a part to play. How do we steward our gifts? We be humble like Christ. We be the body to one another. We be obedient. Whatever gift you have, use it. Now, there's some of you this morning who might be saying, well, I don't know what my gift is. I invite you to read Romans 12. I invite you to read Ephesians 4. I invite you to read again this passage in Romans 12, 3-8, or 1 Corinthians 12. I invite you to ask somebody you trust in the faith who knows you very well, what do you think my spiritual gift is? Whatever gift you've got, God expects you to be using. Now, in this season of pandemic, in this season of unknown, in this season of not knowing what's ahead, a lot of us have become so paralyzed. But the work of Christ should never be paralyzed. The work of the kingdom should never stop. There's no pandemic that God is not working in and God is not working through. And here's the thing. I want Jesus to come back. But I know Jesus ain't coming back till all the work is done. So if you're not working, you're keeping my Savior from coming back. And I'm going to be selfish this morning. I need you to get to working. Because this world is dark. And I can't wait for heaven. But we can't get there if there's still work to do. And if there's work to do that you're not doing, you're holding us from heaven. So I need you to be obedient. To not just identify what your gift is, but to actually give it to God and say, God, use me. God, take me. Remember, the gift is not about you. It's about what God can do through you. And if this world is dark and you're not shining your light, why are you letting your people suffer in darkness? If this world is broken and you're not going to mend it and heal it, why are you letting people suffer in pain? If this world does not know what Jesus' love is, what it feels like, what it looks like, why are you not helping them see Jesus, the true Savior and lover of their souls? We have to steward these spiritual gifts by being humble like Jesus, by being the body to one another, by being obedient to serving. And lastly, we steward our gifts by being faithful. And I share this story a couple of times a year because it stuck with me. I had a mentor who would always tell me, you got all these dreams. You got all these hopes for the world. That's beautiful. But you know what I need you to do? I need you to focus on the here and the now. And it was deeper than just being present where you're present, which is a great lesson, by the way, right? Especially in this time. Be present where you're present. I'm still working on that one. Just ask my family. Be present where you're present. It's a good thing to work on. But what she meant was that whatever God's put in front of you now, be faithful with that. It's not a bad idea. It's not a bad thing to dream of what you can do and all the ways God can use you. But if you're just dreaming and you're not walking, if you're just dreaming and you're not doing, if you're just dreaming and not living right now to serve the ways God is calling you to serve, if you're not being faithful, those dreams will just stay dreams. Because here's the thing, when you're faithful with a little, God will use that little to grow like a mustard seed. When you're faithful with a little, God will put his trust in you and give you just a little bit more. When you're faithful with a little, God will do a lot with it. You know, on Christmas 1997, I was 14 years old. I was a sophomore in college. And you know, the leaders of my church called me in, and I was just like, did I get in trouble? What's going on, you know? And they said, hey, we think this year for Christmas service, you should preach the sermon. I remember thinking to myself, like, these people are a little wild. You know, I'm 14 years old. How am I going to preach a sermon? And then of all the ones, you're going to pick Christmas Sunday, like two of the three Sundays that, you know, people actually come to church, right? Like, everybody's going to be there, you know? And I remember that was my first thing. But I remember the trust they showed in me. You know, I said, we didn't take this lightly. We prayed about this. And we really felt like God might have this gift in you. And God might have a message that we need to hear. And they said, we want you to do this. And at their trust in me, I went from, oh my goodness, these people are wild, to, oh my goodness, these people are really wild. But after that, I was humbled that my church was able to see something in me before I saw it in me. And this gift to preach is something that they nurtured in me. And it's something that they started even before I could see it. You know, I might have been 14, I might have been only in 10th grade, but I was already starting to teach Sunday school. I was already starting to speak up in some of our other services. It was something that they not only gave opportunity, but they kept nurturing in me. And that body is why I'm here today. You know, I've always been comfortable in front of a crowd, but that body believing in me showed me it's possible that this gift that might have not even seen or fully understood was being nurtured. So when I got my call to preach, it was really just being obedient to God. And I remember when I first took a job as youth pastor at this church, people who knew me for a long time were just like, what took you so long? You know, we told you this is what you're supposed to do. And I was like, where were you from 17 to 24? Because that would have been really, really helpful. You know, and they're like, well, we tried to tell you, you weren't listening. And that's the thing about obedience. Obedience is not just submission to God in thought, but it's actually listening. Listening to his call. You know, I preach now, hopefully, in the sense of being faithful to not only God's call, but faithful that when I come to the scripture, the Holy Spirit's going to open my eyes to show me wondrous things. The Spirit is going to speak through me. Jesus is going to be exalted. Our Father is going to be glorified. But I bring all that up to say, when we talk about stewarding these spiritual gifts, we have to look at it, not just individually, but as a body. And when we look as a body, the question becomes not how can I develop my gifts, my skills, my abilities. The question becomes how can I be humble with what God's given me? So when I'm using this gift, I'm looking not like Hank, but I'm looking like Christ. How can I use these gifts not for me, but for the kingdom of God and for the kingdom? How can I use these gifts in an obedient manner so that God is being glorified? How can I use these gifts in a faithful manner? So I'm going to end a little bit differently this morning. I'm going to end by asking you these four questions. If you got a pen, write it down. You're watching on YouTube, so you can pause, right? Or you can get out your cell phone and type it in. But the four questions I want you to wrestle with and then hopefully answer this week are just simply this. How has God gifted you? And if you want a full list, again, go to 1 Corinthians 12 or read again this passage in Romans 12 or Ephesians 4. But how has God gifted you? And if you're not sure how God's gifted you, call someone who really knows you and ask them the same question, and they might be able to help you along. Second question is simply this. How are you presently using your gifts? Because like I said, a pandemic is not meant to paralyze the church of Christ. God has given you gifts for his glory and his kingdom in every season. So how are you presently using that gift that God's given you for the glory, for the kingdom, for the equipping, for the empowering of your sisters and brothers? How are you presently using your gifts? How? Number three, how can your gift be nurtured to maturity? Because we all got to grow. We all got to grow. One of my favorite stories by Henry Nouwen is when he tells a parent who's struggling with a teenager, and he says, the greatest gift you can give to this world is to be a growing person yourself. We are all meant to grow, because if we don't grow to maturity, we grow in uselessness. And God has no desire to have uselessness in the kingdom. Everyone is self-sufficient? No, that's what the world tells us. Everyone is expendable or only worth what they can give? No, that's what the world tells us. God says everyone has a place, everyone has a job to do, everyone has to grow in that job, in that gifting, so that they can be mature in using it for the kingdom. And maybe to sum up all these questions, how has God gifted you? How are you presently using your gifts? How are you maturing your gift how are you nurturing your gift to maturity? The last one is simply this. How is God calling you right now, in this season, in this moment, where you're sitting, in your life, in your world? How is God calling you to be faithful? We're called to steward our gifts. Be humble like Christ. Be the body by belonging and loving one another. Be obedient to listen to the Spirit of God. Be faithful with what God's gifted you. Let's get to work, sisters and brothers. God bless you.
God of justice, Savior to all, came to rescue the weak and the poor, chose to serve and not be served. Jesus, you have called us, freely we've received, now freely we will give.
must go. Live to feed the hungry, stand beside the broken. We must go, stepping forward. Keep us from just singing, move us into action. We must go to act justly every day, loving mercy in every way, walking humbly before you, God. You have shown us what you require. Freely we receive now, freely we will give. We must go, live to feed the hungry, stand beside the broken. We must go, stepping forward. Keep us from just singing, move us into action. We must go, we must go. Live to feed the hungry, stand beside the broken. We must go, stepping forward. Keep us from just singing, move us into action. We must go. Fill us up, send us out. Fill us up, send us out. Fill us up, send us out, Lord. Fill us up, send us out. Fill us up, send us out. Fill us up, send us out, Lord. Fill us up, send us out. Fill us up, send us out. Fill us up, send us out, Lord. Fill us up, send us out. Fill us up, send us out. Fill us up, send us out, Lord. We must go, live to feed the hungry, stand beside the broken. We must go, stepping forward. Keep us from just singing, move us into action. We must go, we must go. Live to feed the hungry, stand beside the broken. We must go, stepping forward. Keep us from just singing, move us into action. We must go.
And I'm going to do announcements this morning, and I just wanted to remind you that you can find all the announcements and details of the announcements in your Journeying Together email that comes out weekly. You can also find tidbits in the beginning and the ending of our service on slides. So this morning first, we want to take a chance to say thank you to everyone who's given to VBS and to the project that's happening with the well in India. And we wanted to let you know that so far we have collected $2,053 for the well, and we have about $4,000 left to go. So we want to encourage you to come on and keep giving. It's open indefinitely, and it's a worthy cause. And you know, God, even a cup of water, God compensates for us, so any little bit helps. We have two places where help will be needed. Mission of Mercy is supposed to be coming back on August 20th, and they have their own COVID precautions that they're taking. So I just want to encourage you that if you want to help out in that way, and they're looking for interpreters, they're looking for nurses, and they're looking for someone to take registration. If you need more information, you can give me a call, and I'll give you the contact information. And the other one is for backpacks. We are still doing backpacks, and we're doing curbside pickup, and that's happening August 8th. And if you would like to help with that, I need all the help I can get this time because of COVID. I'm willing to come and deliver stuff to you so that way you can pack it up for me. I can set up a time where you can come and be in the church, and I can be in a separate place while you and your family serve together and pack up bags. So call me, and then we can set up, you know, a time that'll be good for you, and then we'll see how comfortable you are with helping us, and I'll work with it. All right, so otherwise than that, have a great week. We miss you and can't wait to see you again.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise for you only. Life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise to your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you. Shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord.
What a great blessing we have that our God actually trusts us to do his work. You know, it humbles me, but it also terrifies me, if I'm honest, right? That the God of this universe has said, you know what, my son is preparing heaven till he's perfect, but I'm going to leave behind you, my children, on earth, and you, the Holy Spirit, and you're going to do his work together. But God, in asking us to do this work, gifts us to do this work. He gifts us with many different ways and many beautiful ways, but he asks us to steward these gifts. Our call, our work, is to be humble with our gifts like our Christ was humble. It's to be the body living like we belong to each other and loving because we belong to each other. It's being obedient to listen and to follow the Spirit, and it's to be faithful. That's how we steward our gifts. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you so much that you trust us, that you entrust us, that you equip and you empower us to do your work. Lord, for the gifts in this body, we thank you that you've given us all we need here at Harrisburg BIC to not only impact our individuals, to not only impact our families, to not only impact our city and our region, but Lord, yes, even to impact our world. So we thank you that you've gifted us and entrusted us and equipped us. Lord, now, Holy Spirit, help us to be empowered to go out and make your kingdom come. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much that we have you as our example. Grow us in humility. Holy Spirit, help us to hear more clearly your voice. And Father God, teach us to be faithful like you're faithful. For Lord, when we steward these gifts, when we live in love, when we're obedient and we follow and live like Christ, your kingdom come and your will is done. Lord, help us to steward all that you've gifted us. Help us to steward one another. Help us to love you as you loved us. In your holy and precious name, amen.
Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise for you only. Life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you. Your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise, your breath.